Everybody, welcome to our conversation between John Sculley and myself. My name is Peter Diamandis, and pleasure to be spending time with all of you. The one, the only John Sculley, past CEO of PepsiCo and Apple. John, good morning to you. Good afternoon.
Thanks, Peter. Good to be together with you again.
Always a pleasure. I'm broadcasting to you from Soho House here in Malibu. Where are you this morning?
I'm in my home in Palm Beach, Florida. It's a beautiful day here, and we've all adapted well to the COVID-19. Let's say I wouldn't even call it a lockdown now, because we're able to, I do my runs every morning on the streets, and we walk on the beach. Still do my Pilates by FaceTime, so life is pretty normalized for me.
So I thought it would be fun to talk about two subjects this morning. And then, of course, we'll open up to questions. We're broadcasting to the Abundance Digital community, as well as to a number of our social media platforms. So welcome, everybody, from wherever you might be. I think the two conversations that I'd love to have and then open up for Q&A is, number one, what are we seeing as the near-term future of society and the medium-term future of society? For the long-term, I think we can – I'm not going to go there, because it's that's when you start hitting the impact of the singularity and exponential technologies. But for near-term future society, and then one of the things we mentioned, we talked about on our last joint webinar, was the companies that we're invested in, where we're spending our time, where we're investing our capital and our time and so forth. So let's start with where we see near-term society. So one of the things, I was doing a broadcast with the CEO of an AI software company called Unbabel that does translation. And he's based in Lisbon, runs an organization of a couple hundred people. And Lisbon, Portugal, has just begun opening up. And a lot of Europe is going to sort of be the advanced over the horizon radar of what we're seeing in the US and South and Central America and such. And he was saying that, I asked him, how much of the lockdown quarantine changes of society have stuck with you as you've reopened? And surprisingly, he said very little, that people are back in the gym, back in the coffee shops. There are many people are going back to the office, and there's FOMO, fear of missing out, of not being in the office, people are going back in the office. Kind of surprised me, but not. What are you seeing, John?
Well, I see in Florida, where I live, that young people are out on the beaches. They're now eating at restaurants, but they're eating outside, because we have a climate that's perfect for that. And from that standpoint, it's normalized. On the other hand, we're seeing the number of infections from COVID-19 actually going up here in Florida, particularly in the dense parts of Florida, which is South Florida, where I live in Palm Beach. So I think that particularly people who are younger and healthier normally, they're coming snapping back fast. Some may argue too quickly, because if you look at some of the demonstrations, we've had a lot of demonstrations here in the West Palm Beach and Palm Beach area, because of Mar-a-Lago, the president's home is here. So when those demonstrations occur, people are going around without masks on. They tend to be younger people. And so they aren't paying much attention to the COVID-19 suggestions on wearing masks and things of that sort. But I'd say young people are snapping back very, very quickly. What isn't, I think, going to look like pre-COVID-19 are so many businesses. Many industries are going to be dramatically changed, and not going to be, that they already are changed just in the short time that we've had the lockdown for COVID-19 here in the States.
It's interesting. Are you wearing a mask? So this is, I just got this from a friend of mine, Garrett Gerson. Garrett is the CEO of Calamigos Ranch. He's a XPRIZE Innovation Board member. He's also CEO of a company called Variant. And it's a 3D printed mask. And it's actually one of the most comfortable masks that I've gotten. And so I love this. They're creating a version of this that's coated with silver nitrate as a antimicrobial, antiviral. But the challenge is societally, it's not American culture to wear these things, either for your own benefit or for those around you. You know, the question is, can that change?
I think it can. I mean, the mask I wear here is nothing special about it. But it's not one that's easy to talk through and breathe through as the one you're demonstrating. But think about this. I mean, there was a time when Americans said, there's no way we're going to wear seatbelts unless someone absolutely forced us. Well, we were forced to, and we just now take it for granted.
That's an interesting analogy of seatbelts.
So my sense is we hope that, and I know we'll talk about this later on, that there will be a vaccine and that by this time next year, we're all going to be feeling a lot better about how we can deal with a coronavirus. Because remember, the coronavirus may not disappear, but it could mutate into other forms and maybe it'll become less of a serious health issue. But there'll always be a coronavirus of some form because there's been coronaviruses for maybe hundreds of thousands, even millions of years. My sense is that if we have to wear masks, we'll adapt to it and we'll have really good masks, more like the one you showed than the one I'm showing here.
We're working for folks to watch out for. We're getting ready, working on a next generation mask X challenge, X prizes. That we'll be announcing shortly, and try to figure out why people don't wear masks. What's the main reasons you don't wear? You don't like the way it looks. It's uncool. It fogs up your glasses. All those things. We're going to be running a survey starting the end of this week, and then blasting it out to actually find out why people don't wear masks, and then have the next gen mask challenge really address those issues, and then begin the mask manufacture. So stay tuned on that. So what's going to stick around? I mean, one of the things coming out of this, what do you think the long lasting, when I say long lasting, I mean, a year to 5 years from now, dividends out of this pandemic is going to be, John? Any top ones for you?
Well, I think what we have observed so far is that we have an amazing culture in the United States of people being able to adapt. So not only are we going to continue to see the effects of exponential growth technologies, but I think we're going to see the effects of adaptive innovation, the ability of, particularly in our culture in the United States, of if there's a problem and it has to be dealt with, we're pretty good at figuring out a better way. And I think that's a characteristic that on the one hand will still put the United States in the driver's seat for a lot of the innovation that will take place throughout the rest of this decade. On the other hand, because our culture is such an individual focused culture, we're kind of messy about how we do things. And I think it's one of the reasons why we are failing as much as we are versus other countries in the world, which are far more disciplined. I remember in Italy talking to friends in Milan who said that they walked out on the street and if they didn't have their mask on, they were given a 100 euro fine. Or if they were walking on the street at a time of day, they weren't allowed to walk on the street, 100 euro fine. We haven't done anything like that in the States. And so I think we're kind of messy on the one hand as a culture, on how we pay attention to good practices like social distance, like wearing masks. And on the other hand, I think we're very adaptive and we'll figure out how to do new things.
Yeah, I agree. I think that what I've seen, and we can pivot to this conversation, is I've seen a lot of business plans coming over the transom on robot kitchens, on robot delivery, on at-home healthcare. So this is really putting the individual in control of their lives and increasing agility of every aspect of our world. So I probably the same for you. I'm seeing let me pause one second. As I think about where I'm investing my capital, either for my venture fund or personally, I'm mostly focused in biotech and AI, and that those are the two big places that have the disproportionate returns and the ability to make the biggest impact in society. So let's talk a little about that a little bit, where, in terms of where you're invested these days, and where I'm invested these days. What companies are we on the boards of? What companies are we helping run?
Sure. Well, the only thing I would add to what you've said, because you and I are both vice chairman, and you're a co-founder of Cellularity, a biotech company, we're both invested into AI. I mean, the reality is you can't really be in tech today and not invested in AI, or at least ML, machine learning.
Yeah.
One of the ones which we're doing really well, all the companies I'm invested in were at one point early stage when I got invested into them. Today, all of my investments are late stage, and fortunately, they're doing well as late stage companies. I'll give you an example. One of the businesses I got into almost 6 years ago is what's called robotic process automation. Robotic process automation is machine learning and AI. Where you're literally taking these smart bots, hundreds and hundreds of them, and you're enabling them, these little subsystems with the ability to learn and adapt, and then to be able to work in clusters with each other. And it's amazingly successful. So if you think
to basically replicate what a human is doing.
Yeah, even better than humans, because what smart process automation is doing is that machines don't make mistakes, humans do. And if you can combine machine learning and AI with these smart bots and get them to work together in clusters and take on sometimes menial tasks, sometimes complex tasks, as you're in the case of what we're doing at our company, RX Advance, we actually are taking the healthcare system, everything from the prescription drugs side of it to fraud, waste, abuse, misuse, avoidable medical expenses. And that's about $900 billion a year that McKinsey Global Institute estimates. We're going in and we are solving problems that hopefully show the way where hundreds of billions of dollars can be saved, not only by our company, but others who will adopt robotic process automation to go in and take tasks that look complex, but when you break them down into minor tasks that can then be solved by these smart robots, and then collectively you're solving big tasks, you can literally take hundreds of billions of dollars, not tens of billions, hundreds of billions of dollars out of the U.S. health system. And that's just one example.
I love it. What else, where else in the AI world are you playing?
Well, I've been involved in what's called 3D medical sensors. I mean, we all know the first generation of sensors for wearable devices have been simple things like tracking your activity, counting steps, and then being able to build profiles from it, give you, guidance as to, where do you need to improve. But the next generation, and by the way, this is not science fiction. These are we're actually working on products that are ready for commercialization. We are taking sensors, and we're doing 3D sensors. We're combining both machine learning and AI, and we're able to, for example, we can with our technology, which is a it's a harmless electrical field that we can look through a lady's breast. We can see a cancerous tumor in the breast long before it would ever be discovered by a mammogram. And if you get that early enough, Peter, and you can get that tumor out, nobody would have to die. We're now taking that into other areas, like looking through the epidermis and being able to see a melanoma, cancerous melanoma, without a biopsy. We're now looking at pancreas candidates for transplant, 70% of pancreas candidates for transplant are thrown away because they really don't have a guarantee that they're going to be adequate to be transplanted. Well, we can select which ones. Again, we're using AI and machine learning combined with our 3D sensors. And we do the same thing for blood glucose monitoring. We're able to look at different blood constituents like electrolytes, like potassium and sodium. We can look at tracking, you know, things like hemoglobin for HDL and LDL. All these things we're now doing with 3D sensors and AI and machine learning.
Awesome. What's the name of that company?
That's called Zedson. It's a London-based company. So, you know, American Z is called Zed, and it stands for sensors, Zed, Z sensors. So Zedson is a team of physicists, artificial intelligence, data scientists. We have electrical engineers. These are all mostly PhD level people. And it's an amazing team over there.
I see. And you and I, so it's interesting, right? Because I'm seeing cancer being attacked from 1,000 different directions. AI and machine learning being two of the very important ones. But then we're on the board, as you mentioned, as co-vice chairman of Cellularity, which is using natural killer cells, the innate immune system that is in your body right now, finding and fighting cancers. And I have to imagine that we have the potential to make cancer a thing of the past at the end of this decade. That in the next 10 years, we're going to slow, stop, prevent, be able to fully treat almost all cancers. Is that your guess as well?
Well, I don't have your deep medical experience, but I'm lucky that I get to hang out with smart people like you. And it is definitely a theme that I hear over and over. Again, but I'm on the East Coast, so a lot of the people I'm in regular contact with are in the Boston area, New York area, and they, you know, would very much, I think, be aligned with what you're saying.
So let's talk one second about Cellularity, give everybody an update. So there is a brilliant entrepreneur, Bob Hariri, MD, PhD, pilot extraordinaire, who back a couple of decades ago, realized that the human placenta, which is, I think of it as a 3D printer that manufactures the baby, right? Provides all the stem cells to produce that baby, that it's thrown away at the end of birth and as the afterbirth. And you actually pay when you give birth to your children, you pay for that placenta to be incinerated and disposed of. But that placenta is very rich in a number of cells. It's rich in stem cells, pluripotent stem cells. It's rich in natural killer cells, T cells, and so forth. So Bob, as part of a startup that got sold to Celgene that became a $100 billion company, inside that, Bob incubated a cellular medicine division that John and I helped him spin out to form Cellularity. And Cellularity is one of the largest manufacturers in the world of cellular medicine. This is cells delivered intravenously into your bloodstream as a medicine, where those cells, you can think of them as input-output devices that sense the what's going on around them and then will put out an exudate or will go and attack. So there are two products that Cellularity is now manufacturing. It's got a beautiful plant that Bob is running. And one of those products are natural killer cells. And the other product is stem cells, placental-derived stem cells. John, you want to talk about what we're working on right now there and what we're finding?
Yeah. The other thing I would add is that during the time that a mother is developing her child, the woman is largely immune from almost everything. And so one of the great advantages of the placenta blood cord stem cells is that they carry with them a generalized immunity for many things, and they are allogeneic, meaning that they will not be rejected by whomever they are infused into, which is a big difference from other cell therapies which have come before Cellularity, where you have to extract the blood, process it, reinfuse it back in. And then there are always unexpected complications because of side effects. You don't get those kinds of side effects from the placenta blood cord stem cells. So the really exciting thing to me is not only are we showing huge potential with efficacy for things like glioblastoma, acute myeloid leukemia, and multiple myeloma, where we have INDs, innovative new drug designations from the FDA to do these trials. But importantly, we can scale because we can cryopreserve our stem cells. We can have a supply chain and a manufacturing capability. We've built a factory, in fact, spent $75 billion of CapEx to be able to produce at scale, which means if you put it into the context of T cells, which has been the big breakthrough for things like stage four lung cancer, we're still only talking about a few thousand people have ever been treated by these T cells today, even though it's a remarkable accomplishment. The big promise of the natural killer cells that Cellularity is productizing now is that we can scale to orders of magnitude more patients that can be treated. I mean, it really says that precision medicine, and as you pointed out, Peter, why we feel confident that cancer can be eliminated is you've got to eliminate cancer at scale. It's just not eliminating, you know, a small number of patients. And so Cellularity is really one of the first companies in the cell therapy world to actually set an expectation that we can do speed to scale. And we're actually building the capacity and the supply chain to be able to accomplish that.
So, yeah, thank you, John. If I could, for folks, one second. In our bodies, we have two parts of our immune system. There's an innate part of our immune system, which is composed of principally these natural killer cells. And these natural killer cells in your body right now are zooming around your bloodstream in all your tissues, and they're looking principally for two things. They're looking for cancer, and all of us are always developing cancers all the time. And your immune system finds your cancers at the very beginning and destroys them. And it's when your immune system loses that ability that the cancer then can develop and grow. So the second thing that our natural killer cells are doing are zooming through our bodies looking for viral infections. And if they find cells infected by viruses, they kill your cells that are virally infected to stop that viral infection. And so what we've learned, and this is the genius of Bob Harari, Bob said, why don't we think at augmenting your own immune system? So by transfusing into your bloodstream 100 million cells to 300 million cells, different protocols, you can help fight, in this case, multiple myeloma. We're now beginning human trials in glioblastomas. It's a deadly brain cancer that has no good treatments at all. In animal models, these natural killer cells really pummel and destroy this. So, you know, fingers crossed that this will be a treatment, an efficacious treatment. But it also works for virus infection. So we have an open IND, investigational new drug designation, and we are now treating patients that are on ventilators who've been infected by the SARS-CoV-2 virus and have failed other treatments. So fingers crossed, early good news, but can't discuss it openly. But that is what Cellularity is doing. It's one of the largest manufacturers of stem cells, T cells, natural killer cells, and such, derived from the placenta, which is sort of the earliest stage, purest form, has gone through nature's quality control program of taking a baby through to proper fruition. So, John, what else are you excited about involved in? And I'll share one of my other companies I'm involved in right now too.
Well, one of the companies I'm very excited about is our founder of this company. By the way, I only work with founder businesses because I learned in my time in Silicon Valley just how different and how important founders are. They're given more latitude and they're willing to take more risks and do more courageous things particularly when you're out on that bleeding edge of innovation. So one of our CEOs, who's founder of a company which is called On Demand Pharma. On Demand Pharma is basically focused on the issue that 90% of the prescription drugs that are consumed in the United States are generic drugs. In other words, they've come off of patent. And almost all of them are made somewhere else. 70% come from China, up to 30% of them come out of India. There's some that are getting source materials from China or India and making them in Israel. But for the most part, there's nothing being made in the United States. And so there's been a huge push by this administration to say, we've got to have a US source that'll give us a guarantee of the quality of the active pharmaceutical ingredients that go into these generic drugs, because we just don't know. And when they're tested, we're surprised that that there is no quality control of names that we're so familiar with as generic drugs over here in the United States, because they're coming from largely China. So what we did, we got some technology that we acquired from MIT about 7 years ago. We've been working on it for quite a few years now to commercialize it. We're at that point now where we've fully productized it. And we're able to work at the pharmacological level, where we're taking the chemistry of essential elements like carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and we are then taking them through pressure, through temperature, through other processes. We're able to create the active pharmaceutical ingredients. We're now up to about 35 well-known generic drugs. We'll probably get up to eventually about 100. And we built what's really different in the pharmaceutical industry. Pharmaceutical products are done on a batch process. We're building a continuous manufacturing process, much like we have at Cellularity. And our continuous manufacturing process happens to be in a manufacturing in a box the size of a home refrigerator. And so
you're literally able to like stick a full pharmacy in a box at a hospital or apartment complex.
You got it.
That's crazy. That's awesome.
And we've been given emergency approval, as Cellularity has, for some of our COVID-19 treatments. We've been given FDA acceleration to get this out. We have a significant grant from DOD, Department of Defense. They'd like to see these eventually in every military base, U.S. military base around the world. Homeland Security loves it. They'd like to see them in fire departments around the United States and hospitals. And obviously, every prototype, the first machines are about $500,000, but like everything in tech, the prices will drop dramatically.
This is like the Star Trek replicator. I'd like some XYZ drug, please. And
we have an amazing CEO who's a PhD pharmacologist, comes out of the military as well. He was a senior officer at DARPA for many years, which is how he discovered this company, this invention, really. It wasn't a company at MIT. And it's a very exciting thing to be a part of.
Beautiful. Two quick companies on my side. We're going to be doing a webinar next week with Morgan McDermott, who's the machine learning AI neural net genius behind Future Loop. And I'm so excited. John, one of the things we're doing with Future Loop is we're reinventing how we gather information and how we then present it to people in a way that is just not negative news all the time. It's really seeing the news through filters. And it's just not any kind of filter. So for example, one of the things we can do is we can create a neural net version of you, John Sculley, based upon all of your tweets, all your social media, all of your writings and so forth. So we create a neural net, and I can then search the world's news by virtue of what would John Sculley be interested in reading. And then I can see the world's news through John Sculley or through Elon Musk or through Ray Kurzweil or whomever. So actually, one thing I'd love to do, if I'll ask you permission now, but I'll ask it again officially later. Can I create a John Sculley avatar that we can have as a pull down option on Future Loop, so the world can like see the news through your eyes? I think that would be a fun thing to do.
Well, that sounds totally cool, and I would love to be a part of it. And by the way, I'd love to get inside the head of some of those other Future Loop people you just mentioned, like Ray.
Yeah, so imagine if you can actually see the news through these people's eyes, but you can also see how the future of industries through their eyes. That's what we're trying to do with Future Loop, and it's rolling out heavily over the next few weeks. And then the other play, so that's my AI play du jour. The other play in biotech besides COVAX, besides Cellularity, that I'm hugely, as you are, a fan of. Bob is brilliant, and the company is just rocketing right now. And what is Bob's Twitter handle? I always want to let people follow him. It's at Hariri Robert, I think. Well, someone, if you guys would just text me Bob's Twitter handle, and I'll make sure that I can mention it for folks. The other company is COVAX, which is a U.S. fully U.S. startup of a company that came out of Taiwan and China, and we have built the most accurate in terms of sensitivity and specificity blood antibody testing. We partnered with the National Pandemic Center, part of University of Nebraska Medical Center. It's that services the White House, the Pentagon, the Joint Chiefs out of Nebraska. We partnered with them. They looked at all the different blood antibody tests, and we partnered with them. We're now supplying in batches of 1 million these blood antibody testing to countries around the world. But we also have developed, we looked at 30 different vaccines, and we're going to be rolling out the data on the results of these vaccines this week. In animal testing, we went from 30 down to 6, down to 2. For a vaccine to work, it has to have 3 attributes. First, it has to be able to, when you vaccinate, it has to create a large antibody titer. And our lead candidate is orders of magnitude more antibodies than other published data. It has to be, it has to have antiviral, it has to basically neutralize the virus. And again, there we're seeing orders of magnitude higher neutralization, and has to be manufacturable and has to be safe. I guess it's a fourth thing. And manufacturability, this platform we're using to manufacture these vaccines, we've manufactured over 5 billion vaccines. That was in animal health, but we're manufacturing in humans, in human health for a range of different from Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, hypercholesteremia, migraines, and so forth. So COVAX, watch out for that. It's super fun. And it's the speed, John, at which this stuff is happening is insanely fast. Insanely fast.
So Peter, how would you give some perspective for all of us in terms of what's your expectation of when we will have a vaccine that can actually be scaled to cover the populations?
So that's the key. That is the key. It has to be effective and has to be scalable, right? So we're hearing about 4 or 5 vaccines that are coming our way. But the reality is we're seeing manufacturing, because most of them are biological processes. Like the vaccines coming out of China will work, but they're using basically originally live virus that are being beaten up in that regard. Our vaccine for COVAX is a chemical process. It is not a biological process like you've done with your other company. It's a synthetic peptide process. It's more like mixing paints than it is, growing viruses and chicken eggs and so forth. So we can scale to, 500 million doses a year, 1 billion doses a year, and we're planning manufacturing capabilities in Florida, perhaps Texas as well. We will see vaccines coming online before the election. I think we're going to see this administration push for approvals for vaccines. The question is how many? Will it be 20 million doses, 40 million doses? And the question is how well will it work? How long will it immunize you for? One of the questions, we still don't know if you've gotten infected by COVID-19, how long does your immune system fight the virus? Is it a year or 2 years? Is it for life? We're going to have so many PhD theses written on COVID-19 for epidemiologists. It's not funny. So I think we'll see 4 or 5 approved at or near the new year into the first quarter. But I think we're going to be seeing manufacturing rates of, for each one of these, like 40 million, you know, maybe 100 million. But we have, you know, we have near 8 billion people that are going to need immunization. So just like in the influenza business, there's like 4 or 5 major influenza vaccine companies and like 20 minor ones. So we'll see a whole mix of these guys.
So if you take the seasonal flu, and we do get vaccines every year, some work better than others, but not everybody takes the vaccine, and yet we seem to survive it. What's the practical side of this? You know, can we get to a third of the population with the vaccine in the right parts of the say our country? Yeah. And that'll make a difference?
Yeah, I think it's actually, the interesting question is going to be, are you going to vaccinate those that are the most vulnerable, right? And be able to have antiviral treatments for those who are vulnerable. So like cellularity's natural killer cells, like if you're older and you get this, can we give you a treatment to get you over it to augment your immune system? By the way, Bob, I had some people asking, it's at Hariri Robert is his Twitter address, H-A-R-I-R-I Robert. Let's go to some of the questions. We have a huge number of questions in our last 23 minutes here. Let's jump in. Jerem.
Hey guys, so our first question is going to be from Regendra. And she's asking, what would be some meaningful new technology or repurposing of existing technologies that could be useful for the millions of people who have recently lost their jobs? How do you both stay optimistic about the future economy in the current job market?
Let me take that on first, and then John, over to you, since you've employed more people than I will ever employ in my life, the companies you've run. But we're getting ready to launch a rapid reskilling XPRIZE, really to get entrepreneurs to help people get new jobs. And now let me just be clear, a lot of the people who have lost their jobs have lost jobs at companies that were tanking anyway, because they were old school companies and they just were hanging on. And the goal is, how do you take someone who's lost their job at an old school company and give them a new set of skills that allow them to jump onto a company that has much greater upside and gives them much greater fulfillment and such? And how do we reskill using AI, using VR, using augmented reality? These kinds of technologies are coming that can help someone learn very fast. John, what are you thinking about in terms of getting people back to work?
Well, I have kind of two parallel tracks that are different from one another. And I'll start with the first is, I'm a great believer that smart automation, meaning machine learning, AI-enabled automation, is actually going to create jobs, not just destroy jobs. And of course, there'll be many jobs that are done today that can be done better and cheaper with smart process automation. But at the same time, the ability to bring in AI and machine learning and be able to think of the types of things that can be done with these technologies as a tool. I mean, we are accustomed for hundreds of years, ever since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, to think about tools. And it's no different today, except that the tools this time won't be a pocket calculator. The tools will be the ability to take people and to reskill them in, I think, very effective ways, but it's going to be orthogonal, meaning it's going to be dramatically different than the way people have been accustomed to going to school and learning in the traditional forms of education. The other one I would point out is the gig economy. It was only about a year ago when the projections were being made in the U.S. that we were going to be approaching 50% of the U.S. workforce would be in the gig economy. Gig economy essentially means people who are individual contractors or people who pretty much are self-employed. And they can be anything from people who are doing landscaping, other jobs that require using their hands, to people who are going to have very high skills and who are going to be not necessarily working for a corporation, but will be working for themselves and employed by corporations. And they may have more than one employer in that model because they may have divided their work up into working on particular projects of beginnings and ends, and they may be working on several and simultaneously. And those are the people who are going to be, I think, advantaged by some of the new technologies, particularly AI and machine learning on reskilling. But then there are a lot of other people who are probably not going to have those types of jobs in the future. And so my sense is that when we come out of this coronavirus, when we come out of the election, 5 months from now, the election's over, right? And at one level, it doesn't make too much difference what the outcome is. It's just as important to say we will have an outcome. But at this time, we have the lowest Fed fund rate, certainly in our lifetime. It's almost at zero. We have the banks who have incredible amounts of capital on hand right now, more than they can actually deploy. There's a huge need for infrastructure to be built in the US. The Fed has also shown an appetite to do things the Fed hasn't done, certainly in recent years, and that is to just keep putting money supply out there so that we get through this coronavirus. And that's one of the reasons why I think you see there's so much optimism in the economy, even though we all know that we don't have an immediate solution to COVID-19. So I think that 2021 is probably going to be a very good year for getting jobs back, getting people employed, some people getting employed in entirely new jobs, people getting reskilled, which will take a while, people in the gig economy being good at finding jobs when they're out there. So I suspect that the world's going to look a lot better a lot sooner than it may feel to people right now.
Awesome. Jerem.
All right, up next is Elma, and she says, with the disruption and demonetization of commercial real estate and the globalization of teams, where do you both see potential for disruption of residential real estate? Will rents and house prices drop? Will leisure and travel be less or more expensive post-COVID?
Wow, a lot to unpack there. So it is interesting on the residential, on the commercial real estate, that a lot of companies are looking at saving money on not going back to the office, letting go part of their leases, allowing people to work from home. And I'm very curious about how much of that will stick and how much of it will require people to try and come back in the offices. Again, this is something, it's hard to know, but I've seen a lot of companies that I'm on the board of or am in communication with their CEOs that are reducing their office footprint. And you've seen, Google and Facebook and others saying, hey, plan to work from home through the end of the year. And these are long enough periods of time that we get new habits. On the home real estate, I think the biggest impactor of that isn't COVID-19. I think it's going to be the autonomous delivery systems and autonomous cars and flying cars and robot delivery and so forth, that there are parts of LA like Topanga that are beautiful, but I would not want to live there because I'm worried about traffic on certain days. If there's like, there are one lane roads that get you in and out. So if all of a sudden I can have stuff delivered by aerial drone or robot drone or aerial taxis and so forth. So a lot's going to change on relocating where you live and where you work. John, what are you seeing in the residential real estate side?
Well, I particularly like that last couple of sentences you said, where people are going to be at least having the opportunities to rethink where they live. I mean, the reality is that communications are only going to get better. So whatever we're accustomed to today on communications as 5G and other related enhancements roll out, communications will be higher quality wherever you want it. And I think that means that if you look at it over a decade, that by the end of this decade, we're gonna see good examples of new places to live and work that might not have been obvious to us who are adults, but will become totally interesting to younger people who have to scramble right now to find jobs, find places to live that they can afford. So I suspect we're gonna see growth of the medium-sized cities around the United States and eventually go out another decade and you'll see the creation of even brand new cities that will be enabled by a lot of the technologies you were talking about, Peter. So yeah. I think the other thing is that what does a home look like? No young person has much ambition, I think, to have these mega mansions anymore. I think the status symbol of a mega mansion seems almost ridiculous to a lot of young people, but they want to be able to have the freedom to travel, do what they want, and experience many, many things during their lifetime. And so a home that ties you down is almost contrary to where their lifetime is going to open up possibilities. So I suspect the footprint of homes will be smaller. I suspect we'll even see communal type structures where people share certain common rooms. Think of apartments where you have bedroom suites, but you have common areas that people share. I suspect
I call those capitalist communes, and where you've got conference areas and you have living room areas and kitchens and so forth. And if you start a company, you know, if you're 40 of you in a company, you might move into a capitalist commune and live and work together in that regard. But the other part that's interesting is, imagine if you had a unit that you own. At one point, I looked at a business plan that was using shipping container homes that you would put in place. And if you wanted to move from New York to Rio, you could swap your contents of your shipping container with someone there and all of a sudden just relocate and be plugged in to a location. I still think it's a good business plan to be had by one of you entrepreneurs out there.
Yeah, well you know, one of the greatest innovations, and unless you're my age, you don't know it firsthand, is the invention of container shipping. And it was laughed at when it was first proposed as an idea that you would have to create these containers and you would put your goods in the container and the containers would then be loaded onto ships or into rail cars and they would have to move through the supply chain. Well, now you can't imagine anything but that. So there may well be something like the prefab home or the containerized home or people willing to experiment and look at entirely different concepts. I studied architecture for some time when I was young in graduate school. And even then we were starting to consider, so what would be the lifestyles that people would be living in decades later? And it seemed like science fiction at that time. It doesn't seem like science fiction anymore.
Jerem.
Up next is Soraya, and she's wondering what your thoughts are about fintech and e-commerce. Online reporting says that technology in those areas is lagging behind by about 10 years. So she's wondering what exponential growth could look like in those areas, and what would you have to do in that industry to thrive in the post-COVID world?
John, any thoughts on?
Sure. Well, in fintech, I think it's pretty clear, Peter, that blockchain is going to be foundational to fintech, and the banking world is working on it. It's a simple idea, but it's complicated to get it fully integrated into our financial system. Just like creating currencies that are not paper-based currencies, will eventually happen, and it takes time. So I think that we will definitely see blockchain, and as I think most people know, blockchain is a distributive model where all of the data in a transaction stays with the transaction. And that seems completely practical with the cost of storage going down, with the cost of communications going down, with the ability to scale these types of systems at very low cost. It seems like an easier world to envision, where a blockchain becomes a significant part. Not only does it provide security, but it gives you huge efficiencies for anything that is following a transaction, like a supply chain transaction will. And as we see more and more technology, whether it's omnichannel or e-commerce, it's only going to make more and more sense. And so I'm pretty certain that blockchain is going to be a big part of our future, and it will take a lot of technology around it to take full advantage of it.
I think 100%. I mean, the question ultimately is, when do we get to a globally recognized digital currency, and will we get there where the friction for moving capital is super simple, right? I mean, the ability for me to donate a penny to a writer who wrote something super cool, the ability to move currencies in micropayments without having to worry about the overhead, I think it's going to unlock a brand new means. And there's a lot of pressures. I think people forget that we're continuing to globalize an extraordinary rate. We're about to see Starlink, SpaceX's constellation. They're dedicated 20 launches this year to launching the Starlink constellation that will provide 100 megabit, eventually multi-gigabit connections and to every square meter on the planet. And with that level of agility, if you can move money that fast as well, right? It's gonna just kick into gear, orders of magnitude more entrepreneurs, testing, trying, playing, and I think my last book, The Future is Faster Than You Think, is gonna become continuously true. Jerem, let's grab a couple more if we can real quick.
Sure. Up next is Sarah, and she's wondering what you both think about the future of AI in creative sectors, such as music.
The future is bright. We're going to see AI helping people become creative everywhere. So if you don't have a musical bone in your body, but you know what you like when you hear it, or if you don't have an artistic bone in your body, but you know what you like when you see it, imagine being able to have a partnership with an AI that is a musical creator or a artistic creator. And you can say, hey, I don't like that. Could you add some more cello or some more energy or whatever, and have it iterate. And so you're guiding it by your intention, your generalized intention. And this is where we're going to have a lot of human AI collaboration in creating stuff, where the AI is able to use algorithms to make sure everything sounds good and is smooth. And maybe you give an AI a library of all the artwork you like or the music you like. You say, make stuff like this. Are you part of the creative process? John, what do you think about that?
Yeah, well, I guess I come, I went to RISD when I was at Brown, and I went to the Graduate School of Architecture when I was at the University of Pennsylvania. And so I tend to think visually. And so from a visual standpoint, the idea that we put a picture on a wall is really, you know, a constraint of what was possible going back, you know, hundreds of years ago. Well, with material science combined with artificial intelligence, combined with systems that can learn and can learn from almost anywhere, I think it's going to be totally reasonable in the decades ahead that walls will become visual without putting a picture on the wall, that the materials of the walls will be able to display artwork, which will be, in many cases, created in real time by artificial intelligence.
Depending on your mood.
And your mood. So exactly, and your mood. Personalized to your mood, which may be different than my mood at that particular moment in the same space. You know, so you see it one way when you're in that space. I come in later and I'm sitting in that same space and I may see it entirely different. And so when you think about innovation, you sometimes have to kind of break out of what we think you have as the parameters, you know, that give you the boundaries of innovation. With AI, a lot of the innovation is going to take place where we haven't had the freedom to break the boundaries. And we all know that augmented reality and virtual reality are getting closer and closer to a new reality. And whether it happens in the next 5 years or the next 10 years, it doesn't make much difference. We just know ultimately it's going to happen, and AI is going to be able to take advantage of that.
You know, it's, we're out of time here. I'll wrap with a 60-second story for myself, and then let you have the last word. I was at the Sistine Chapel. I was walking through, and it's like, oh my God, this is magnificent. This is gorgeous. But, you know, there's no way, even if you're a billionaire, if you wanted to recreate this, there's no way to recreate this at this level of beauty. And I said, well, actually, I could just create, like, you know, 3D printers that would print beautiful versions on the wall. I said, forget about that. I'll just have white walls and have my augmented reality glasses superimpose whatever I want to see in that moment on the walls. And so it's literally dematerializing, demonetizing, and democratizing access to the best artwork on the planet for free all the time, everywhere. All it has to get to is your visual cortex, and you can bypass the old style of things. So John, hit us with a couple words of wisdom for the next minute or so as we wrap up here.
Sure. Well, I remember when Steve Jobs and I spent 5 months getting to know each other before I actually signed on to Apple. And Steve said, look, I want you to come and teach me marketing. And I said, okay, what? Why? And he said, well, he said, I have a completely different idea of the future of computers. I believe that they're going to be to empower non-technical people to do amazing creative things. And I also discovered, and Steve acknowledged it, that there was something in Silicon Valley at that time called the Steve Jobs reality distortion field. that nobody else, you know, believed what he was saying. And I said, Steve, you know, marketing is pretty simple. Perception leads reality. When you have a perception as clear and as big and that you believe in as much as you do, the job of the marketing is to be able to take that perception and make it feel so real that it crosses the boundary and it actually gives people an understanding as to what reality is going to be in the future. And so when I was working with Steve, everything we did in marketing and design was to make computers, you know, look like the reality that we were pointing to, even before we had the true capability in those computers to do everything that Steve imagined. So it was always Steve's brilliance and his ideas, but taking that and formalizing into perceptions of advertising, product design, prototypes, things like that, helped cross that boundary of the reality distortion field.
Beautiful. And for all of you out there, the best way to predict the future is to create it yourself, including distorting the future into the vision that you have. May you have a hopeful, compelling, and abundant future ahead, everybody. John, I look forward to doing this again with you.
Thank you very much, Peter. Good to be with you.
Take care, pal. Take care, everybody.